2020. You've been delayed because of the pandemic, various secondary reasons, and even had everything credited, and this service was going to be done March 22nd, I think, of this year. That's when this was printed. And the Lord said, wait. So we have to wait to celebrate this. Why do we celebrate? We celebrate victory because of Christ our Lord and His victory. And so in that vein, we remember God's graciousness, Arnold and his life, his graciousness throughout his life. And a great man that supported him and was with him all the way. And now so we celebrate. So let's begin with that hymn of celebration for all the saints from their labor.
Make our beginning this morning in the name of the Father, who created Arnold, and of the Son, who redeemed him, and the Holy Spirit, who kept him in faith. Amen. In holy baptism, Arnold Meyer was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness, who covered all his sin. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Arnold and to all your servants who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Psalm number 121, we read responsively. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade upon your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out, your coming in, this time forth and forevermore. From Philippians chapter 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Holy, 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 please be seated.
Thank you.
especially shortly after he died, and in the months ahead. As he talked, sometimes there was a period of silence. There's no word to be said. But there's always something to be said, and that's the word which we read this morning, the word which sustained him throughout his life. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep.
For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And then from John's letter from the Revelation of St. John, chapter 21, verses 1 through 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away." And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the springs of the water of life without payment." And finally, the Holy Gospel from Matthew 25, verses 1 to 13. Please rise in honor of the gospel. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. But when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered, "Truly, truly, I say, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. Our next hymn, "Chief of Sinners, Though I Be."
Thank you. In the great name of Jesus, amen. That hymn says it all, right? Says it all. We're all sinners. We all come before the Lord with just begging for his grace, and Jesus brings forth his grace and his life into our lives. Even though chief of sinners though we be, yet Christ has died for us and set us free. And so today we celebrate this freedom that Arnold has. He's no longer burdened by the stuff of life, no longer burdened by the aches and pains of life. He's with the Lord. And so we thank God for this man who influenced our lives in so many different ways, as a friend in Christ, as a brother in Christ, as one who was a fellow member here at Town and Country. Maybe you know Arnold from other venues of life, his profession, his vocation, as family, as son or daughter, as a grandchild, as great-grandchildren, and we have how many great-grandkids? Seven. Number seven. Yeah, that's a good number. Yeah. So what a wonderful group we have here today with family and friends remembering Arnold. Well, I remember the first time I met Arnold. It's about a couple of weeks after I accepted the call to come down from Mount Olive and Folsom to Town and Country here in Sacramento. And I needed somebody to help me with all my books in my library. And I was at Folsom, Mount Olive, and there coming into the driveway was a man in a 65 Ford truck, you know? And I thought, that's a cool truck. And anyway, Arnold and I packed all the boxes, all the books, and then he, right outside that gate there, we opened the gate, which isn't open to very often, but for that time, it was open so that I could get my books in the library, and he was so gracious and so helpful. I've entitled the message Builder, because when I reflect on Arnold, he has what it takes to be a builder and had what it takes to be a builder. He was a visionary man. He was an idea man. He saw beyond what was in front of him and what could be. Maybe that's the best phrase that I would share. Arnold saw what could be. And dovetailing with that, we have Arnold as a planner then. You know, you can have an idea, you can have a vision, but you need some planning to do this building, don't you? And not a few times did Arnold call me up and say, Pastor, what are you doing? And I go, well, Arnold, I'm getting ready for Sunday. No, of course, other things. He said, well, do you mind if I come on over for a couple minutes? And so I'd see him come down the pathway here, and he's got the spiral notebook in his hand, and I go, oh my goodness, he's been thinking again, he's been planning again. And let me tell you, he didn't just come in there with a couple of sheets of paper there from that spiral notebook that had a couple of ideas. He had the entire vision, the project, thought through and through, all the way to the finest detail. He had a plan. He's a planner. And I thought, boy, that Arnold, after he left maybe about an hour, hour and a half after he came over, I said, that Arnold, he's a thinker. He's a planner. And with that, he had the trait of being attentive to detail. No stone was unturned with Arnold. He thought it through. With either the project here to build this sanctuary so many years ago, 1967, 68, to the Friendship Center, so many details. And I know some of those details burned him, trying to think of everything that could be possible in the building process, everything that needed to be given attention, every little detail. And sometimes when you have a profession that, or some projects that take a whole lot of out of you with a detail, you need to do something almost opposite. Like if you're so into your vocation that it causes such details, sometimes it's just good to be more artistic, sing a song or dance or something like that. But Arnold was a little different. He really was one of the most astounding woodworkers that I've ever met. And so that attention to detail really found relaxation in finding more detail. Maybe it was the sanding, the polishing, the finishing that made it so therapeutic for him and his detail with his woodworking. And many of us here today probably own some of his works of art, be them shelves or a desk or whatever it may be, that he brought forth in an artistic piece of wood. Arnold was one who looked at performance. He was committed to knowing and doing what was necessary to help others succeed. And in his projects, he also would talk about what are our roles as individuals, as a team. And he helped the team and he helped the individuals in that team succeed and have the stuff that they needed to be successful with the performance of their tasks. And so many of us here today may have been influenced by his encouragement as we serve the Lord here at Town and Country, or serve the Lord as family, or serve the Lord in any realm, that he was one who was an encourager, who was really behind you, said, you could do it, you can do it. And build, just a simple word, build. After a project is completed, you can see in Arnold's eyes that his idea or someone else's idea came to fruition. And the project that was being built now was completed. To stand back and take a look. I know Arnold's family and friends were dear to him. And for him to stand back and with a gleam in his eye, see you and see how the Lord, who even he would admit, Arnold would admit this, as the Lord worked through him to encourage you, now you're standing back, he's standing back and did stand back to see you as a completed and wonderful person in God. And use. Buildings need to be used, right? And so Arnold, instrumental not only the sanctuary, but also the Friendship Center. I remember when we had the dedication and Arnold stood up. And Arnold had his way of being kind of like that deep voice of authority, right? And he wouldn't mince words. I remember Arnold saying at that dedication, "Now what?" Maybe you remember those words. Now what? How would we use the building in service to Christ? How would it be used to reach out to the community? And we can look at the last years of that completion of the building with Habitat for Humanity, using it for its annual dinner, for the Upward basketball program, for various ways, the monthly meals and everything that that building has meant, not only to the community, but to us as a family of believers at Town and Country. In fact, this is a direct quote that Russ found in some paperwork as he has been going through his dad's materials. This is the exact quote that Arnold shared on that dedication Sunday. He said, "Town and Country can be a beacon, lighting the way to salvation for this community. We have facilities that can be used for a multitude of purposes. We have people who have talent or time or treasure to staff these endeavors. We have people who are creative and imaginary enough to be visionaries." As we look at these traits concerning this wonderful man called Arnold Meyer, we also realize that these traits were gifts from God. And these traits, I'm going to do a parallel of how our God displays these traits. Because you see, our God is a visionary idea God. Even though he created this wonderful creation, man decided to go on his own way and to rebel against God. And yet God saw beyond that fall of man. He looked ahead and had the vision of bringing a Savior for us. And so God shows his trait of being a planner. And as you go through the entire Bible, you realize that beginning with Genesis 3:15, where you have one who's going to crush the head of Satan, promise. And then you go to Psalm 22, it talks about a suffering, dying servant. And you go to the prophets, and you go to Isaiah 53, it echoes that same Messiah who would pay for the sins, the sheep to be slaughtered. You go to Isaiah 7, where you have Emmanuel, God being with us. You see, as God had this vision, he carried it out with a plan. And a plan to save us. A plan to save everyone on this planet. And call them to faith in what he has done. And see, as Arnold was attentive to detail, so also is our God. Our God is one who over 300 prophecies concerning Christ are in the Old Testament. They're all pointing to him. In fact, you could say the Bible is one that just simply shouts out Jesus. It's all about him. And I would say Arnold would want that to be the primary thing to really shout out today. Jesus. And he's phoning us right now. No. Jesus. In fact, the attention to detail, I'm sure Arnold, as he lived through the church years, seasons, and as he heard the word of God, he realized that here was a God who is not a God of just talk, but he was a God of performance. Because he knew that Jesus, one time, stood up in the temple and said these words, "The blind receive sight. The lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cleansed. The deaf hear. The dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor." Jesus also later said to his disciples, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of man, and they will kill him. And on the third day, he will be raised to life." Then as that actually happened, Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished." And then later in his resurrection appearance to the disciples, Thomas, who had been doubting, yet now stood before the risen Lord and said, "My Lord and my God." God is a God of performance. He did what he was supposed to do. Jesus bringing forth his life in payment for our sin and rising from the dead to give us the hope. Give us the hope that Arnold had and the hope that's absolutely fully realized in Christ now. And then there's the trade of build. Is God going to just make project after project in terms of timber and wood and glass and stone? No. It's his church. His church is not a building. As at one time Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do the people say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And here's Jesus describing his building talent. He said, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." He's not talking about Peter as being the foundation, but the confession that Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the Messiah." That is the rock upon which God's church is built. And that's why we are here today, because of not only Christ building his church here at Tana Country, but also to just thank God for a man who helped build his church here in this place all these years. And of course, the last trait that God brings to us is after Jesus is risen from the dead and he speaks to his disciples. Here you can almost hear the words of Arnold again. "Now what?" Well, the use. So use this gospel. "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." Today, we celebrate a man who influenced us in so many ways, but he, most of all, as I was privileged to know him the years that I was here, to know him as a man committed to the gospel, committed to seeing Christ's church built, not only in buildings here on this campus, but through the Spirit of God bringing people to faith in Christ. And today, as we remember Arnold the Builder, we thank God for building a place for Arnold that will last forever. Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you. I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. And somehow, I can't stop thinking that Arnold may, with God's permission, be adding some finishing touches on his own. Amen. Family, would like us to take a look, and maybe you've already read the brief synopsis of Arnold's life, but if you can turn to the back of the bulletin, I'd like to share with you again a synopsis of his life. Arnold John Meyer was born December 9th, 1927 in Carroll, Iowa. He passed quietly due to cancer the morning of October 15, 2020 at the age of 92. Frieda Baumann, the love of his life, became his wife on April 24, 1949. They had 47 wonderful years together. Arnold is survived by two sisters, Darlene and Louise, son Russell, daughter Carolyn, three grandchildren, Jennifer, Michael, and Stephanie, and seven great-grandchildren, Noah, Lakeland, Caleb, Isaiah, Luke, Olivia, and Jake. Did y'all hear your names? Yeah, hi. Great, I thought you would. All right. He was preceded in death by his beloved wife, Frieda, his parents, John and Elsie Meyer, and one sister, Florence. As an Iowa farm boy, Arnold learned many life skills. And during World War II, he joined the Navy and was stationed in sunny San Diego. He loved it. No snow. In the summer of 1959, he moved his family to Sacramento, California. And for the next 60 years, he was a member of Town and Country Lutheran Church, where he served on many boards and committees. Serving as volunteer building supervisor of the fellowship hall was among his greatest challenges. Near the end of Arnold's life, he was instrumental in presenting the idea of a senior living center to be built on the church's property. He would be glad the idea may come to completion in a revised form. During his working career as a computer programmer and manager, he worked in the Sacramento area for San Juan Unified School District, Los Rios Community College District, Independent Data Processing Center, and the city of Sacramento. His hobby was woodworking, making sawdust. He enjoyed making furniture, cabinets, bookcases, and anything that people needed. He delighted in the planning as well as the making of each project. Many people are enjoying the evidence of his woodworking skills. Amen. I invite you, as we finish our service today, in just a few moments, to even share special memories you may have of Arnold with his family and with one another. Let us now stand as we confess our faith, as our brother Arnold did so many years here at Town and Country. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we sing the hymn, Just As I Am.
Please stand as we pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. You are the light of the world. Give us a peace. We ask for us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Hear us, good Lord. Give to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have the strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. Give strength, good Lord. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Grant us grace to entrust Arnold to your never-failing love, which sustained him in this life. Be with us all as we continue life with precious memories of him, and always give thanks to you for how he impacted our lives. Hear us, good Lord. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and has taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
Thank you.